I was hoping it would roll around a bit more. And interesting thing with the males. Male wildebeest are very territorial. So they will set up small territories for themselves. And usually what happens is once they've set up a territory, and it's usually in an open clearing, maybe with a little water hole or something close by. They do need water, so if there's a water hole close by, that's great for them. But then there are two other things that they do need in their territory, or that they want in their territory, and the one is a rubbing post. So they'll find a little tree or branch that they're able to go and rub up against and scratch themselves. And the other one you'll see a lot of is basically a dust bath area. So a little sandy patch that the male's probably scratched up, and he will roll around. And there's another one dust bathing just off to the right. There we go. It was rolling. Let's see if it does it again. And those males will go and roll around in that little wallow. And they'll dust bathe, and they'll wear that little patch out quite substantially over time. But those are the things that are needed for a wildebeest to have a good little spot of territory. Now I'm going to move on from here, but Tristan has managed to stick with Mvula. Let's go and see what that beautiful leopard is up to.
Well, he's just sitting in the long grass and he's watching. He got quite close to that herd of impala that I was talking about, and they all started to alarm and go crazy, but they were facing the opposite direction. So I don't know if maybe there's another leopard in this area. I haven't been able to check around too much because I'm scared we're going to lose him. But I think that maybe that young male that Tayla saw could also be here. Now, wouldn't it be incredible if we get Sindile and Mvula in the same sighting? Now, that's a wish that we shall hope and pray for, but it seems at this stage that he's just going to sit and watch these impalas and see how they are. Now, for those of you that have just joined us, my name is Tristan, and on camera I've got Craig, and like I say, we are live with Mvula, the male leopard. He's one of the oldest males that we have here, and it's really a treat to see him. We don't see him that often. So if you are a new viewer and you want to know anything about the leopards, please send through your questions at #SafariLive. And even if you're not a new viewer, if you have any questions about Mvula and you haven't seen him in a while, please be sure to ask us and chat with us and let us know how you feel about seeing him again. It is really, really, really good that he's back in this area. And like I say, I'm sure that there's another leopard because there's no wind to speak of. So I don't think those impalas could have smelt him. And the impalas that alarmed call were quite far from where he's lying now. And I went a little bit and checked a little bit there, but I didn't see anything. So I wonder if maybe there's not another leopard that is hiding out somewhere in these thickets. Right, so we're going to stay with Mvula and see if he starts hunting these impalas. And while we do that, I believe Tayla is in the middle of a postcard scene on Djuma.
We are indeed. This could be Wild Earth's next Christmas card with a cat's tail grass, the beautiful view of Vuyatela Dam, and the last of the golden light. And wasn't that beautiful that we managed to just this shitty get a gap between the clouds of about that much where we had the wonderful sun just poking its nose through. Now, of course, we're out on a bushwalk at the moment, and my name is Tayla. I've got VM on camera, and of course, Herbert standing there very handsomely posing for everybody this afternoon. I like to try and make Herbie blush all the time. And it's not just a beautiful scene that we've got out here this afternoon. We've actually got something else. Where are you? There it is. No. Now, it's actually going to be quite nice in this elephant dung, if you look very carefully. No, 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 come back. It's now bouncing along the road. VM's going to have to play a bit of cat and mouse. I'm actually going to move away from it so I don't scare it too much. But you saw, that is a tiny little frog. And unfortunately, I can't get too close to it, otherwise it keeps running away. But it's about the size of my thumb. My thumbnail, that is. It is teeny tiny, so I'm thinking that it's possibly a sand frog. Maybe the tremolo sand frog. You can actually see it's actually breathing quite heavily at the moment. So it's a little bit nervous. It's okay. It's very brave being out here, of course, as well, in the big wide world with all the different birds that are around that we'll be possibly snatching it up. That is a lovely shot, Viam. That is really, really wonderful. Now, what would be nice is that if we could find a reed frog sitting on a piece of grass so we can do a silhouetted shot over the dam, but I think that could also be asking a little bit too much. But this is a tiny little critter that would be going after things like insects. There's lots of insects at the moment. Actually, if you take a look towards the water's surface, you'll actually see it almost looks like it's got waves. It's moving. There's lots of tiny little ripples. And those are all little bugs. The biggest splashes that you might see every now and then will be catfish and frogs and terrapins coming to the surface to snatch up some of those insects on top of the water. Some of them could also be fishing spiders moving around, which is very lovely to see. I'm enjoying those fishing spiders. Bye, frog. Yes, go to the grass where it's a little bit safer. I think it's quite silly that it's sitting out in the middle of the open. Luckily, it has got very, very good eyesight. What was I going to say? I've now completely forgotten what I was going to say. Anyways, Rebecca has said we can go and have a different view from the dam cam. Let's take a look now. Ah, you see us walking. Wave, Herbie. Wave. VM also have to wave. He can't. Hey, see, he's so good. He doesn't need to have two hands on the camera. But yes, we are standing here on the dam wall now, just having a beautiful look at the scenery. And it's actually a lovely spot. I reckon for a guest to come and have sundowners down here would be absolutely stunning. Maybe not looking towards the lodge, but maybe from the other side. But this little natural pan that is now filled up is really, really quite something. And I hope it lasts. I actually was hoping the other day that we had a bit of rain. I thought we were going to get some lovely big rain, maybe 20 or 30 mils of it, so that it would top up this water level. But this should last quite a while. I reckon the temperature is definitely dropping, so the water is not evaporating as fast of a rate as what it was. Also, there are now many different dams. VM, please don't walk off of the edge of the dam wall. should we show them where the elephant? Come look at it. Actually, we found something funny that I have to show all of you. We're going back towards the frog now. But we were just saying how the elephants lately, and we saw it at Treehouse Dan, we've seen it here. The elephants all going up the steep bank. It's like they're enjoying the exercise or the challenge. But look at this. I'm not going to imitate the elephant this time because it is exceptionally steep. Look at this. Whether it was youngsters going up and down here or a big elephant bull that was desperately trying to get towards a herd, or perhaps he was thirsty after a long day's walk, who knows? But they were going up and down this massive steep slope, and if I were to try and do this, I would end up on my bottom and tumble all the way down, not to my death, but it would be very sore and I'd have a couple of bruises on me too, so we won't be demonstrating that today. Oh. It's really lovely. This is really, really spectacular, and I kid you not, a scene that we've got at the moment, the lodge, the hardy das calling, the ripples on the water, the golden light, it really is breathtaking, and I hope that you all took a couple of screenshots. Remember to hashtag Safari Live with them, but we're going to go across to Tristan now, who has also got a similar view, but he's looking up at the sky.
We are indeed. Is that not the most spectacular sky? But Taylor, we have one thing better than your picture postcard sky, and that is in the little right-hand corner there is Mvula sleeping under this beautiful skyline. So it really is quite something just to be sitting with this wild leopard under these clouds with the sun illuminating the cloud structure. It's a very, very pretty scene. Now, it would be nice if he was a little bit more out in the open and you could see him a bit better. Imagine if he was in a tree with this as a backdrop. That would be quite something. But nonetheless, it's still really, really great to be spending so much quality time with him. Now, he's just sleeping at the moment because I'm sure he's knows that these impalas have alarm called and that they're on very high alert. So what he's doing is he's just resting. He knows they're not going to go far. They're going to be staying close to this open area. And so he's just sleeping, waiting until they rest a little bit and they get more relaxed, and then he'll start probably hunting again. So it's worth sticking with him for a little bit longer. I know he's been very, very sleepy at a lot long stages of this afternoon, but it is worth staying with him a little bit longer. I'm sure he is going to start hunting again just now. Reese, the health ailments that the leopards will go through. Well, as males get a little bit older, there's a number of things that start to happen. First, they do wear down their claws and their teeth. So from all these years of crunching down on bones and these carcasses, their teeth start to wear down, and then that becomes very, very difficult for them to feed properly. They start to really battle to shear off pieces of meat, and then they use their tongue to try and kind of lick pieces off, but they don't really get the same nutrition. They also go through a phase where they start to, the muscle starts to break down a little bit, their joints start to swell up, and they start to get too much like a human. Their sort of range of movement gets less and less as ligaments start to calcify and get a little bit more sort of rigid. And after that, once they start to get more stiff and less range of movement, they struggle to be able to hunt. So they get into a situation where they can't chase animals effectively, and therefore they're not getting the nutrients that they need. And then they really go through this phase where there's just absolute muscle dystrophy. So their body basically consumes themselves to try and stay alive, and they basically break down their own muscle, because there's no fat left or no fat deposits, and they're not gaining enough nutrients from the food, so they basically digest themselves and the muscle breaks down completely. And then you get a situation where the skin is just basically draped over bones, and from there this poor male leopard will then be too fatigued and too tired to be able to go after anything, and he would then pass away from that. So there's quite a number of things. They also come into contact with younger males that are fitter, and sometimes they fight with them, so they get lots of bite wounds on them. They get sort of injuries onto the feet and leg areas, and that's normally a death sentence for an old leopard. Once he's got an injured leg, he's really going to struggle with anything. So these are the kind of ailments that happen to a leopard as he gets older. It's much like us as people. It's the same thing. Our body just starts to break down after years of moving around and utilizing them. So he will be the exact same. You can see that he's very, very static at the moment. He's not moving at all. Not even the ears are flicking. And there are a number of flies today, so I'm surprised that we're not actually seeing too much movement from his ears. Oh, there we go. Now, I reckon him and the Styx female from this morning could have a competition as to who can move the least but flick the ear the most. They, both of them, this morning the Styx lioness was absolutely dead still the whole morning, and then we got a few little ear flicks, and Mvula's doing a good impersonation at the moment. He's exactly the same way, not moving a muscle other than that little ear twitching every now and then. But this is the perfect place for a leopard, just to wait out the afternoon and to start to sort of wait for those darker hours to come. It's nice and thick, long grass, going to be very difficult for anything to spot them. In fact, we almost drove over him trying to find him again. And so while we were doing that, you know, we just kind of bumped into him. So it's the same thing with the impalas. They're not going to be able to see him, and eventually they'll kind of move around and he'll be able to get really close without being seen, and then he can start to hunt. So, like I say, it's worth staying with him this afternoon and worth spending time and seeing what unfolds as the evening starts to close in. Now, while we do that and we watch what he gets up to, let's go across to Byron, who I believe is going forging deeper into Arathusa on the search for different critters.
I am going deeper and exploring a little bit here, Tristan, but no luck just yet. A nice little area. There's a lot of big marula trees around me at the moment. And apparently I have to reintroduce myself. Hi, I'm Byron. And Dave is on camera. So for those of you who've just joined us, we also out on drive and we saw some lions earlier. I'm going to head back to them a little bit later and see if we don't get some activity from this male and female. We'll see what else we can find. Maybe there's an elephant wandering around here somewhere, or a leopard perhaps, another leopard, that would be nice, or anything, so a new antelope, different antelope. And so this area that we drive around in, now I'm trying to think exactly. The traversing that we as Wild Earth have is probably about, I would say, 4,000 hectares, maybe. 4,000 or 5,000 hectares. So that is probably about, about, call it 9,000 acres, somewhere around there. I think that's what it works out to. I think that's what we have, the traversing that we have. But we are part of a greater Kruger National Park, and these areas are all open, so the animals move freely throughout this whole area. There are no fences keeping them from moving over across onto different properties. They So Paul, you were wondering if the animals were able to leave the game reserve. So this area, they would be able to move from here into Kruger and vice versa and move all over then onto the different properties. However, there is a perimeter fence right around the edge of the greater Kruger Park. But that a lot of those animals never see those fences because it's such a vast landscape. I mean, the entire area is probably around 3.2 million hectares or 7 million acres, call it somewhere around there, given parts of Mozambique that are joined in and that entire game reserve. So it is a massive, massive area. It's larger than some European countries. So to have this area looked after and protected and have these animals move freely and we don't interfere with them, which is the other exciting thing. These animals are completely self-sustaining. And this is a natural habitat, a natural system. So we are purely here to view, observe and appreciate wildlife. And that is really a magnificent thing to be able to do. And also to bring it to you live on safari every day so that you can see what a safari is like. You don't just drive and find animals and action happens all the time. You've got to work hard, you've got to drive, you've got to look, you've got to listen to the bush and really appreciate every little thing that you see. Just like this beautiful sunset that we've actually got over here. Hold on a second, look at that little gap. Lovely sunset behind the clouds. Just peeking through. Beautiful color. See if there are any birds calling nearby that we might be able to hear. I can hear a little hornbill somewhere behind us, but very faint. And then in the distance, a little carrachain button quail. Now, I mentioned this yesterday or the day before, the word carrachain or carrachani or carrachain. Everyone's got their own way of pronouncing it. I've always just said carrachain. And that's a button quail. It's got that deep, quite a deep call. Very interesting sound for a little button quail. I'll show you what it looks like because we don't see them very often. Let me show you quickly. It's calling in the distance. Sometimes you get a little glimpse of them when they fly out of the grass, but look how well camouflaged they are. Have a look at that. That's the little button quail. Very, very small quail, but incredibly well camouflaged. And if you have a look around us at the moment, the grass is so long, it would be very, very difficult to spot this little bird hiding in the grass. I mean, look how thick the grass is at the moment. So something like that would hide very, very well. Now, speaking of birding, this morning we were asked about the fish eagles and different eagles, and if the fish eagle female is much larger than the male. And I went and read up a little bit more about it, and because the size or the weight that is given in most of the bird books and bird apps, it's similar. However, with birds of prey, usually the females are a little bit bigger than the males. So with the fish eagle, you might be able to... Oh, hang on. We've got a little guest. Come here. Don't spray on me. Look at that. Look at that. That is beautiful. It's just a little wood borer, I think. But look, little hairs all over the body. Fascinating. Beautiful, beautiful bug. Now, as I said, I think this is a wood borer beetle. A wood borer bug, I think. I stand to correction. I'm sure some of you might have seen one of these before. I often get confused with some of the larger ones. If you do know, or if you've seen one of these, perhaps with James in the tent, let me know. But I think it's a wood borer of sorts. So as I was saying with those fish eagles, the females do tend to be a little bit bigger than the males. But it is difficult to see unless they are sitting right next to one another. You wouldn't necessarily just pick it up. Look at these beautiful antenna. Look at that. See, it just shows you there's always something happening around you in the bush. And this is such an interesting little creature. So prehistoric, actually. Almost alien-like. It's beautiful. Wonderful. Very, very nice. Donna, you're right. I'd say little. This is massive. I mean, have a look compared to my finger over there. How big that is. That's huge. That's a huge bug. Let's see if we... It is indeed, Lorena. It is alive. Have a look at him moving there. Don't want to disturb him too much. Look at the face. There we go. It is indeed alive. That is fascinating. Really great to see these little creatures. I'm amazed by these antenna and feelers that it has. It's also got... Interestingly, and look at this foot in the front. You see those little hooks? So they're able to climb trees and branches and hold on very, very well. And yes, you can. Look, you can see my reflection in the eye. Look at that. How cool is that? That is very, very weird. Oh, my word. That is wonderful. Maybe try get a selfie. Bug reflection. Have a look at this very, very hard shell at the top here. I'm not going to touch him. But that shell obviously protects the head quite a lot. Definitely going to try and look up exactly what this is, what it's called. We have got a few insect books back at the lodge. Okay, well, we're going to move on. I'm going to head back towards those lions. It sounds like Taylor has found the Herbie Herdy. Now, I don't know what you guys have been doing since I've been away, Taylor, but let's go and see the Herbie Herdy.
This is the Herbie Herdy, Herbie Herdy. Wildebeest herd Herbie Herdy. Ooh, yeah. Why I just sang that, but I'm really excited because we came around the corner coming from the dam, and upon our arrival we knew we were going to see our lone friend, the one wildebeest, but he is smiling from ear to ear at the moment because the whole wildebeest herd is back. Whether it's the same herd of wildebeest that we saw during the TV shows with Nat.Geo Wild, I'm actually not sure. It could be any herd. They're constantly passing through, the girls, but they have got lots of little ones. And let's see if, should we see if we can, we'll try and get another view again. I don't think they're going to be as relaxed as the McCurdy Herdy, the zebras that we get. I think that was just by absolute chance. But there's a whole lot of them. They've actually moved off slightly. There must have been about, in total, about 15 of them. maybe even a couple of more. I couldn't see all the youngsters with the tall grass, but let's go and have a look. That was really, really nice. I'm so excited. So that's going to be nice for tomorrow morning, because I'm sure we'll be able to get much closer in the cars than we are able to get on a foot with the wildebeest. But we'll see. So again, I'm going to do the same technique I did the zebras. I'm not going to hide away. I'm just going to walk. I'm not going to walk directly towards them though. And I'll talk loudly so that we're not trying to hide away and pretend that we're stalking them. So we'll see. So we're just going to take it easy, not walk particularly fast. Just slow steps like we're walking on the moon. And as some of you may know, Viam's nickname around camp is Wildebeest. Viam, how did you get that name?
Long story.
Long story, but okay, Viam says next fireside chat he'll tell us about how he got the nickname Wildebeest. And so it could be the Wildebeest herd or the Herbie herd. I don't know what it was now, but it was one of those. But it's really quite exciting. They're actually not running away from us. They've just turned, and one or two of them have turned and are a bit uncertain. You can see them moving. But they're all there, they're just now behind some trees. They're not too bad, so we won't push them too much, also because it's getting a bit dark. It's got getting to that twilight period now. The sun is pretty much about to go down behind the horizon. It's just the last light. And maybe we'll keep approaching these wildebeest on foot, and hopefully the same thing will happen. We'll see if we can get one more view. I think we can. It actually opens up a little bit here. There's lots of bottoms. Beam, can I hear your best wildebeest sound? So Beam, I don't know if you heard that, but that was Beam's wildebeest call. Herbie, come to yours. Come close to me. Herbie, do your wildebeest call. Do it. You're talking to them. Look at that. Did you see that wildebeest? Do it again. The wildebeest, the big bull, snorted back. So obviously Herbie has got the big, best wildebeest call out here at, out of all the Wild Earth guys. We'll have to ask Byron and Tristan to do their best attempts, but I think it's going to be difficult to beat Herbie. That was so funny. Literally, as he did that last one, it did a big snort back at us, as if to say, back off, these are my girls. Now, I'm sorry, Mr. Bull, wildebeest, we are not interested in your ladies. They are all yours. You have been very patient. You have been herdless for about a good month and a half now, at least, if not even a little bit longer than that. So I'm sure he's very excited. And he's going to try and keep these girls as well together for as long as possible and keep them up in this area. And I'm sure that they'll move between quarantine during the day and in the evenings and then go down towards the water to have a drink. Now, Nursey, you're wondering how long is a wildebeest gestation period? It slipped my mind. I think it's 8 months. Please, can somebody double check for me? Maybe you can have a quick search on the interweb. I think it's about 8 months. What do you think, Herbert? The gestation period for a wildebeest. I don't know. My brain is pudding today. I apologize for that. I think it's 8 months. Let's see. 243 to 270 something days. So, let me see. No, I'm just even teasing. Let's do that. It's 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21. Yeah, that's about that. It is about 8 months, 8.5 months. Okay, it wasn't too far off. It was a good guess. I knew it was somewhere around there. I couldn't remember exactly. But of course, it does change from animal to animal, like it does in humans. Obviously, it's 9 months for us, but sometimes it's a bit longer, sometimes a bit shorter. It just depends on when that baby is ready to come out. And well, they've got to be ready, especially when you're entering a world out here in the wild African savanna. It can be quite daunting. And you have to be ready. Baby Gnu, you've said, is Viam my long lost uncle? Possibly he is. Can I show you a picture of him, Viam? We're going to show you and then you have to let us know. And I'm not very good at this. Is that your long lost uncle? He's got horns. Baby Gnu? You look very much like a wildebeest. Okay, there we go, Vim. Not very good at that, of course. You should have seen how awkward I was trying to hold that. I'll just stand this side. But there we go. Possibly he is. You may be right to him and see. Maybe you bumped your passing herds, you know, looking for water, looking for grazing. I'm not certain. But we're going to leave this herd alone. We'll try again tomorrow and see how they react to us. And maybe we build up a good relationship with Herbie's herdy. And we're going to send you back across to Tristan now. I'm actually not sure where he is or what he's got, but he'll tell you now.
Taylor, I suppose when you hear news that Vildi is an uncle, that is exciting, and we then forget everything else. Well, I'm still with Mvula and still sitting and waiting patiently. He is looking around and listening to what's going on around us. There's some button quails that are calling in the distance, which is that low sound that you're hearing in the background. So he's just biding his time. It is starting to get nice and dark now, so there's this cloud on the western bank. The sun has shifted below that and is now going down behind the Drakensberg Mountains. And so we've got sort of dark light that is starting to come through now, and it's going to be dark very quickly this evening, and I'm sure that's what he's waiting for. So he's waiting for the cover of darkness to start moving. Now, there was a male impala on my over my right shoulder for a while, but I don't see it anymore. I think it's moved on. It was somewhere in this vicinity over here, so I think it's now shifted off a little bit more to the west to join the rest of the impalas. But you can see, look how dense it is in here. So this is not a safe place for an impala to be spending much time in the darkness. It's going to be very easy for a leopard to be able to find an impala in all of this, and with this long grass that we have, it's going to be very difficult for anything to spot this leopard at night. And that leopard knows this. It knows that at night this camouflage pattern that it's got is going to come into its own, and it's going to be really, really, very, very tough to be able to see what's going on. So for Mvula, it's all about just resting now and waiting for that optimal time where he can then start to come out and start to see what's going on and start to then hunt those impalas. Like I said earlier, his stomach is not empty. He's definitely had some sort of a meal in the last few days. It's not like he's absolutely famished, and he really actually looks quite good. When I saw him walking over the road earlier, his muscular structure is really good. So even though he's a 12-year-old boy, he still looks quite decent, and his neck area is still massive. He's still got that big broad shoulders and deep neck that has always been his trait, and that then blunt face. So he is still looking very good for his age, which is really great to see. I'm hoping that he's still going to make many, many more memories and sightings for us here on Safari Live. Ooh, Lynette, this is an interesting one. You're wondering if leopards get heartworms. I'm actually not sure, Lynette. It's something that I have never heard of. I've never read anything in any of the literature that I've read about leopard. I have not seen anything about their heartworm, but I have a very good friend who is a state vet and does veterinary or wildlife veterinary, so I will ask him about it and find out whether or not they do indeed get heartworms. But it's an interesting question. I wonder if they do. We'll have to just investigate that further. So if you watch tomorrow morning, I'll try and investigate tonight for you and then be able to give you a more informed answer tomorrow morning, if that's okay. Or tomorrow afternoon, whichever one suits you better, you let us know and I can go into more depth. Hopefully this is going to have broken the leopard drought for us on Djuma, and we're going to get a lot more leopards around, so we can bring up this conversation a lot more in the future drives tomorrow. Hopefully, like I say, the royals will be back. Maybe this is a good omen that Mvula is here and that a Karula will then bring them back. But I also wonder if this is maybe why we haven't seen too much of Karula. Lots of random males walking around. Like I say, if Taylor saw a young male earlier, Mvula being around, maybe she just doesn't feel that comfortable up on Djuma at the moment with the cubs, and so she shifted them further south into the heart of Tingana's territory to be able to keep them safe. Well, Sheila, Karula, I suppose, would mate with Mvula if she came across him and she was in heat and he was able to push any other male away and mate with her. Then yes, she would. He was seen mating midway through last year with Shaluva in Biffle's Hook, so he was still mating midway through last year, and so it's very possible that he will still mate with that female, or with Karula should I say. But the thing about mating leopard is that they make a lot of noise, so if he's mating with Karula, that's definitely going to attract the attention of all these other young boys that are around, and even then of Tingana, who's maybe not young, but is still quite a big boy, and will hear that sound and come and investigate what's going on and why is Karula mating with another male. So it would be taking a big risk, but that drive to mate always outweighs any other sort of risk, and they then do it. So I would say yes, if he came across Karula and there was no other sign of a male, he would definitely mate with her. Right, it's getting to that time of the day. I was commenting on how it's starting to darken up quite effectively now, and it's getting very dingy, and it's not safe for Miss McCurdy to be out in the wilderness walking around. So let's go back to her, so her and the proud new uncle could say goodnight.
Look how close we've got. You know what we did? This is really amazing. We actually just ended up walking straight across quarantine, and then the wildebeest didn't even move at all. They've all sort of grouped up now, with some of them watching us and the rest of them not particularly bothered, heads in the ground, grazing, so that's quite good. And they're all snorting at us. So there could be a number of different things. Wildebeest alarm at people all the time, and the other thing is that with the fading light that we have at the moment, we could be playing a couple of tricks on their eyes, which may be why they are reluctant to move, just wanting to watch our steps and see where we go, because if they run away too far they'll lose sight of us, and that's often what animals will do, is they'll keep repositioning themselves in order to have a good view of a leopard or a lion if they've alarmed and they've given their presence away and that animal is not stalking anymore, and they'll watch it. Like I said, I've seen a number of times where impala have been 20 meters away from lions and big males as they're calling and doing a territorial patrol, not particularly interested in catching anything to eat, and impala moving closer and closer. But now that we're up here on top of the crest, you can actually see how many wildebeest there are, and I think that I was a bit, well, I could have gone a bit more with the numbers and the amount of wildebeest that are here. I reckon there's probably at least 20, if not a couple more. So this bull has really got a difficult task on his hands now, because the bigger the herd, the more difficult it is to keep them in a nice tight circle and prevent them from, well, moving off and out of his territory. A perfect example is how we watch the impala run around and we'll try and get the girls to come back to the main part of the herd. There's much chasing that goes on. Wildebeest don't chase to that extent, but he will constantly circle and keep herding them around to keep them in a nice tight sort of knit group. And this is lovely, and this is where they'll sleep. They'll definitely be here first thing in the morning, so I'm really excited to come back here again to have a closer look, especially to have a closer look at how all the youngsters have grown. Because remember, they're only about 3 or 4 months old now. They're not particularly old, but they're the same color as the adults now. They're not that tawny brown sand color that we were seeing. Remember, we had that amazing sighting with Evia, one of our other presenters that helps out every now and then, where the wildebeest were very young, probably only a few weeks old, and was laying down on a patch of sand, and you almost didn't know it was there. If you didn't point it out, it would probably take your eyes a couple of minutes to adjust and spot something so small. But sadly, it is getting very, very dark out here, as I'm sure that you can see. But luckily, we're on quarantine. We're not stuck out far away in the bushes. Let's keep walking. Now, I'm very allergic to grass or something around here. Every time I walk through quarantine at the moment, I get these welts, and they go away after I put an antihistamine cream on them, and then they don't come back. But I wonder if it's a nettle that I haven't seen yet. There are definitely lots of nettles around at the moment, hey Herbie? Lots of nettles. Or it's a particular grass type that my skin does not seem to like. Yes, I'm now breaking out in these little bumps, but it's all right. We'll have to get some of the marula bark again and rub that all over my legs. Now, some of you may be wondering, our last segment, what just happened towards the end? It was very embarrassing because I sort of stood on an unlevel, a little bit of a divot in the ground, and almost broke my ankle, as you saw. So I don't know if you've ever seen those videos of the girls that walk on the runway with the biggest stilettos and high heels you've ever seen, and sometimes their ankles sort of cave in and they do one of those wobbles and then fall. I basically did one of those. So yes, I didn't hit the ground though. I managed to recover, but it was quite funny. Rebecca said that her and Lou watched it a couple of times afterwards there. But so yes, so I'm always clumsy, always falling down, but it's getting dark now, and unfortunately that's the end of the silliness for this bushwalk. But I hope that you have all enjoyed the walk out here. It's the time today, we're a little bit short with the light, but times are changing soon, and then we'll be able to spend a little bit more time out in the bush. But it's been fantastic, and hopefully the royal families make a return. But we'll see you tomorrow from, well, on the Sunrise Safari.
Well, welcome back to a very sleepy Mvula. He's still not moving too much at all. You can see it is starting to get dark. The light is now taking effect, so I'm sure that he's going to wake up shortly. I know we've been all afternoon with him and he's been quite sleepy, but hopefully he's going to reward us with a very exciting finish to our drive. And also the fact that we've had a bit of a leopard drought, it's quite nice to spend a bit of time with the spotted cat and see what they get up to. It's good to remind ourselves what they actually look like again and how they actually move around. And you can see why it's so difficult to find them at the moment. If you were 10 meters from this, I mean, we're sitting probably, he's now lying, I would say 10 meters, but if you would say we're 20, 30 meters away, you would really, really struggle to see that. And even with the light, there's no eye shine. You can see it's just a broken up mess of spots. And while you're driving, to see that is going to be really very, very tough indeed. So you can see there, from the perspective that we have, it's just looks like grass and a blob in the grass. And there we go, he's lifted his head finally. Good evening, my boy. Hello. So you can see he's just scenting the air a little bit now. So he's smelling to see what's going on. So he's picking his nose up and sniffing the wind. He's trying to ascertain if there's anything around him or if there's any sign of any prey animal that he could then potentially hunt again. I always love when leopards or cats in particular start to wake up in the evenings. You find that they kind of takes a bit of time. They slowly but surely start to sort of think about what they're going to be doing, and their eyes open a little bit and then they close, and there's a very slow process to waking up. It often feels like the way that I wake up in the morning sometimes. I always have to set my alarm 15 minutes earlier so that I can actually be up in time. Now hopefully we'll start to see him yawning. If we start to see him yawning, that's going to be a really good sign that he's going to get up and move. We already saw that this afternoon, is that it's one of those sort of indicators when it comes to leopard and lions. They yawn, they get the oxygen into those lungs and just get themselves prepped to be able to then stand up and start moving. So hopefully we start to see that, and then he does take us for a walk and maybe a hunt this evening. Now we do have the infrared lights that we're going to be using in the Mara, so it'll be great if they do start hunting. Marianne, the grooming process is vital, because lying in grass like this, as I'm sure maybe you've noticed on the bushwalks, we've spoken a lot about ticks. There are a lot of ticks at the moment that are on this grass, and so lying here, ticks are crawling all over him. So that grooming process is great, just to get rid of those parasites that haven't latched on yet. It also gets rid of any fur that maybe has been dislodged while he's been sleeping in the grass and moving around in the grass, so it gets his coat into good condition before he starts to go. The yawning is just extra oxygen into the lungs, and it just helps with him getting that lactic acid moving from lying down for long periods of time, so that when they stand up they're able to go and the blood flow is working quite well. So that's why they yawn before they start getting up. And then, like I say, the grooming is just to keep themselves in good condition. And then you'll find when they, just before they sleep in an area, they actually do the exact same process, not the yawning but the grooming part. And the grooming from that is because now when they walk in, the same thing has happened. Picked up parasites, they've dislodged fur, so it's just to keep the coat in good condition. Also, the grass at the moment has got a lot of seed in it, and a lot of the seeds, like Tayla was talking about, the panicum that she tried to eat and she said wasn't very nice at all, well, that panicum has got a sticky residue around the seeds, and those seeds are going to be sticking to him. So it's just to get rid of all of that and make sure that the fur doesn't get clogged and matted and dirty from walking around in this bush. Then unfortunately you don't have the situation like we have with our domestic animals, that we can brush them and clean them, and that's why they have to take such good care of themselves all the time. But it is absolutely amazing, the camouflage. The camouflage astounds me with these animals. You can see that spotted coat is completely breaking up that outline, and with that sort of grass and the mottled effect of the grass, it's almost impossible to see this leopard lying there. If you had to do a quick glimpse now, if you had just joined us and you weren't sure what we were looking at, I would defy you to spot what is in that grass and tell me exactly what we're seeing. But, so it is really quite something. Right, now we are going to just carry on for a little bit longer with him and just see if he's going to maybe stand up and move and take us on this evening hunt. And while we do that, let's go back to Byron and see what shenanigans he's getting up to on Arathusa.
So Tristan and everyone else, we went past the lions. They're still lying in the same position. They haven't moved. And there were a few other vehicles that are now looking to try and get in to view them, so we thought we'd give them a chance, let them go and have a view. If I was hoping they were possibly moving around, but they're not. They're still lying down on the airstrip. So we've decided we're going to continue and see what nocturnal life we might be able to find on our way back towards Djuma. And that's it, really. That's the update from my side so far. I'm going to get the spotlight out soon, and we'll start having a look for little bush babies, perhaps some chameleons, maybe a scorpion or two. Let's have a quick look there. It's nice that it's starting to get dark a bit earlier, because we have the ability to do that then, look for some nocturnal activity. But I pity those lions didn't move too much, but as we've seen the last few days, there's been a lot of lion movement between the different properties in this area, from Biffle's Hook onto Arathusa, through Djuma. So there's a lot of movement, a lot of activity. So who knows, we might have an entire pride on Djuma tomorrow, and we'll definitely listen out for them again tonight. It always helps hearing the lions call in the evening. We might be able to find something. Let's see what we can find for now. Maybe a caracal, wouldn't that be wonderful? Very jealous that Tayla got to see one yesterday. That is such a lucky sighting. I still have never seen a caracal in the wild, so I'm even more jealous than anyone else. Some of these leaves, it's always difficult because our eyes play tricks on us, and we see what we want to see as opposed to what's really there. So I think I see a chameleon, but having said that, I have spotted a few chameleons in the last few days, so let's see if we can find one this evening. And my tip of the day, oh, what was it this morning? Dave, do you remember? Shake out your boots. Yes, thank you. Shake out your boots. So, and what I was saying was, in the evenings, and I think someone was on the bushwalk and they were looking for scorpions and that. In the evenings and around the camp, there are scorpions that do walk around at times, or other little insects. So the best thing to do is always, when you wake up in the morning, just shake out your clothes a little bit and shake out your boots, or your shoes, just to make sure that there isn't a scorpion that's crawled inside. So that's a bush tip of the day, or safari tip, wherever you are, doesn't matter, but always just check your shoes and that in the mornings, because creatures do crawl around, and they do crawl into boots. So just have a look around, or just be careful. That was my tip of the day. Right. I'm not going to shine the light on it for too long. Actually, just taking this light off, it makes a big difference. Now that looks like a fiery necked nightjar. Oh, there it goes. Oh, beautiful bird. Lovely bird. Really enjoy seeing those little nightjars. And I'll show you while I'm driving quickly. Well, I say fiery neck nightjar, it looks like it is, but it is difficult to tell. There it is again. Let's have another little look. Fiery neck nightjar. Let's just have a look here. Are they? I mean, there we go. Oh, I lost it. It just flew off, but have a look here quickly, everyone. Let me just find, there we go. That's a picture that I saw. Now, you can see very well camouflaged, but it did have that white marking on the wing and some of the flecking, but they all look very similar. But I do think that that was a fiery-necked nightjar. And I'll show you just quickly some of the other ones we might get you. Not really freckled. But I mean, look at that. That looks similar. Now this is a which is this again? This is the square-tailed or Mozambican nightjar. Sorry, Dave. Mozambican nightjar. So it looks very, very similar, but I don't think that we get them coming in through a little bit. But what I've heard the last little while have been the fiery-necked nightjars. But I do think that was a fiery-necked nightjar. But they are very, very difficult to identify. They do all look the same. Anyway, let us continue and see if we can find chameleons or other nocturnal stuff. And Tristan is still with Mvula, but in nocturnal mode. Let's go and have a look.
We are indeed, Byron. We're in army IR mode, so we're in infrared, and this is the new sort of technology that we're trying out, because we're trying to do as much as we can at night without disturbing any animals. So we use the infrared light, which is a very, very low frequency light that goes under the spectrum of our eyesight, so it doesn't blind the animal in any way. You can see Mvula's eyes are quite open, he's looking around, and it doesn't affect them. And so that's why we're going to be able to hunt with these animals and follow them on hunts without worrying too much that we're disturbing him or the impalas or anything else that is around. So it really is quite spectacular to view these animals. And you can see the difference between what we had earlier, how Mvula was just disappearing in the grass. It was really tough to see him. Now with infrared light, you can see the spot detail coming out a little bit better, so it's a lot easier to actually pick him up. It's a really, really cool little piece of technology, and it helps our cameraman a lot. Now, the other thing is that Mvula has been starting to yawn, so he's done two big yawns already. It was a slight little groom as well, so I reckon that he's maybe going to start standing up soon. Hopefully, that will be the case. I'm hoping that he's going to give us another big yawn for all of you so that you can see his teeth. I was quite shocked to actually see the teeth that he's got. They're not nearly as worn as I thought they would be for a leopard of his age. They're still quite healthy, so he's got no problems with his teeth at this stage. No, don't go back to sleep, big boy. No, so back to sleep we go for a little bit, but his teeth are really looking very, very healthy, which is great news. I was wondering if his teeth were maybe a bit worn or any sort of signs of damage to them, but at this stage they still look as though they are okay and healthy. Mama, are you wondering if older leopards ever hang out with displaced young males? Well, they can do. I've seen Mvula, funny enough, even when he was a territorial male, hanging around with young males that he wasn't even the father of, or what we deemed he wasn't the father of. So I saw him when he was hanging around sometimes with Karula's previous litters, so Shivambalana and Shivinzi, and that was back when Jordan was still around, and so in all likelihood Jordan was the one that made it to father those cubs. So he did hang around with them. I've seen him hang around with other young leopards as well. And then we've seen cases where Quarantine hung around with Nkanyeni's youngster, and he definitely did not mate with her. So it does happen sometimes, and it's not just when they get older, it's even when they're younger. But they won't move around for long periods of time. Generally what brings them together is a food item. So you might find that this younger leopard has caught something, and this male has then wandered in and found this younger male, and it then sits and tries to steal the food from that animal. So let's see now, he is starting to get up again. I can see that his head's up, so I'm hoping that he is going to start yawning and waking up a little bit. But yeah, I think a lot of what we've read in books is very area specific, particularly when it comes to leopard. Here in the Sabi Sands, and I'm sure in other parts where the density is high, so places like Yala National Park and in Sri Lanka and South Luangwa, where the density is very, very high, it's Let's do it quickly. We need to go across to Byron. I believe he's got something quite special. So let's get across quickly.
Yes, honey badger, everyone. Look at that. There they go. Oh, my word. Here he is. There's one right there. Yeah, they just run off. Oh, two honey badgers. Yes. Where did they go? They've just gone off into the long grass now. How quickly did they disappear? Oh, no. Let's see if they stick their heads out again. They are very, very shy little animals. I think they're in the long grass over there, but this just shows you how difficult it is to spot them now. Long grass, and they can just disappear. They are skittish animals, but it looked like a pair, perhaps a male and female. I didn't get a good look at them. But what a wonderful little sighting. Very quick, but we got to see them. My favorite honey badger. I can't believe it. Well done, Dave. How great was that? We came up the road, and yeah, they were in the middle of the road running in front of us. That was fantastic. I have been waiting years. I promise you, when I tell you, I have not seen a honey badger for about 4 years at least. And they just... they just evaded me, but it's my favorite animal. I love them. They are so tenacious. They're not afraid of anything. Just incredibly interesting little creatures, and that is fantastic. Oh, that is awesome. Well, there we go. That was awesome. I'm so happy, everyone. The honey badgers, finally. I've been saying since I started at Safari Live that I would love to see some honey badgers while I'm here. And to see two of them now just running around in the road. Oh, that is really, really special. I'm so happy. All right, I think we're going to do a quick little replay of these honey badgers so you can see them again. Let's have a little look at that. Yes, honey badger, everyone. Look at that. There they go. Oh, my word. Here he is. There's one right there. Yeah, they just run off. Oh, two honey badgers. Yes. So I hope you all got a good look at that. Wasn't that amazing? Now, I didn't even have a look at the screen. I was just so fixed on watching the badgers running in front of us. So it just shows you, you never know what you're going to bump into. And that was so great. Yeah, thank you everyone. I'm glad you all enjoying it and that you're also happy. There's a little bronze wing courser. There it goes, just took off. The old honey badgers. Oh, I'm so happy. Oh, that is really, really great. And it, you know, I always say this, but doing what I do, I'm very fortunate that I get to go out into the bush regularly. But there are still animals that we just don't see all the time or evade us. And, I mean, a caracal being one. Tayla got to see it yesterday. And I haven't seen honey badgers for years. And I've been looking everywhere, but you just sometimes you don't see them. So it's just so rewarding when you are doing this and you do bump into those little animals, those creatures that you really love seeing. Everything obviously is wonderful to see, but the ones that you haven't seen for a while, it's just so rewarding to see them. And that is also why I love doing this, is because every day is different. You don't know what you're going to see. Every day is unique. So that was really very, very special. See what else we can find. I feel like we're on a roll. Ah, Andrew, you'd like us to find an aardvark and a pangolin. Andrew, to be honest, we'd get them here, but that's unlikely. Let's put it that way. But they are in this area, and you never know. Stranger things have happened. You do get them around, and we might find them. You never know. But the best place for seeing aardvark and pangolin are in the Kalahari. And those in the Kalahari, you do see those little creatures quite a lot, especially in the winter. They come out a lot earlier because the temperatures drop so much there, and you do get to see them. The habitat's different and the terrain suits them. Now, Tristan has got something small and interesting he'd like to show you.
So we were watching Mvula and Craig pointed this out, and look at this, there are hundreds of spiders constructing a web right next to us, and with the naked eye you cannot see them, but with this infrared Craig was able to pick them up, and isn't that just absolutely incredible? Those spiders are minute, minute, minute. You can see the grass stalks in the background there, the size that they are, so really, really small, and you can see how many of them are busy moving around. Now I have no idea what spider they are. It's really, really interesting. I'm not sure if these are maybe one of the community nest spiders, but they're not constructing a web that a community nest spider would build. You can see it's a long strand that's going out. So I wonder if this is all little baby spiders. And you can see now in relation to the size of the grass how tiny those little spiders are. So it's an incredible spot from Craig. Absolutely amazing. And I know Byron had his honey badger, so he's going to be so excited about that. And Taylor had a caracal yesterday, and I had the jackals yesterday, but this has got to be one of the most interesting things that I've seen. I have never seen spiders in this congregation numbers in night constructing a web the way that these are. It is absolutely incredible. Look at that. It's amazing. Now, it's difficult because the wind is blowing a little bit, so the web is moving. But isn't that incredible? Now, I wonder if these are not brown widow spider babies, because we've got a brown widow spider that sits on Wendy often, and at night she spins these webs on our vehicles, and in the morning we come along and there's been lots of egg sacs, and I wonder now if these haven't come off the car, because the actual web is anchored to the car and it's now coming across into the bush, and all the spiders are starting to head off the car towards the bush. So maybe the babies are making a run for it and they're starting to now go off and live their adult life away from one another. But it is absolutely amazing. I can't tell you how incredible this is. Now, Mvula is still here. He's sitting somewhere in the back there. But we're a bit more mesmerized by this because he's having a very big nap. It's amazing. You would think that that just looks like little floating pieces of grass seed. You can see the finger grass in the background, those small seeds. And there we go. Mvula's just got up and he's starting to go now. So I think we're going to follow him. But weren't those spiders absolutely amazing? I can honestly say that that is one of my favorite spider sightings. Right, so there's Mvula. He's just scent marking in front of us, and we're going to try and keep up with him. It is very, very thick bush, so while we do that, let's go across to Byron and see if he can pull another rabbit out the hat, so to speak, and find us another rarity this evening.
It was a honey badger, Tristan, not a rabbit. we're just having a look around to see what else we can find. Hopefully Tristan's able to stay with Mvula. It's very difficult at night, especially in this thick bush at the moment. Not easy. Michael, you'd like to know what animal we see most at night? Currently it's been birds, so nightjars and bronze-winged coursers, those are the ones that we've been seeing the most of at the moment. But from nocturnal animals, I don't know, it's... Oh, an owl. Oh, there he goes, sorry. Just spotted him. There he goes. There he sits. Beautiful pearl-spotted owl. Hello. Great. So, Andrew, see, we also spot owls. Other animals that we see, I can actually hear pearl spotted owls calling around us. You might be able to hear them too. Beautiful, beautiful little bird. I love these little owls. They're one of my favorites. Beautiful markings on them. And if he turns his head away from us, there. See those two black spots on the back of the head? Almost look like eyes. Make it very easy to identify the pearl-spotted owl. And those beautiful yellow eyes watching us now. They've got that beautiful call that you may have heard. There were one or two calling behind us. They are very territorial. And they give off that beautiful whistle that... Oh, this is really, really great. What a great evening. There, listen. Did you hear that? Could you hear that whistle?
I thought so, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, he's calling for us. See, they're calling to one another. That's a lot of territorial calling or to attract a mate. But how wonderful is that whistle? Did you all hear that? That was very clear. Just to confirm that it is a pearl-spotted owl. Always helps if the birds call and you can confirm it. But the pearl-spotted owl has very distinct markings, those two black spots on the back of the eye. I'm going to take the light off of him now. Lovely little sighting of that owl. Wasn't that great? Eh? Fantastic. Really, really lovely. Oh, James, you say we're yet to hear my courser call. Now, the bronze-wing courser, I need to refresh myself with it. I'll think of it, James, and I'll do it a little bit later. I will do it, I promise. I mean, just, I need to practice these things. I promise, Rebecca, I will do it later. Don't worry. I need to save something for later. John, there are many bird species that migrate in and out of the area. Just off the top of my head, quickly, let's go through some of them. Some of the swallows, then bee eaters, European roller, Warburg's eagles. There are a number of others. There's some little starlings that migrate. There are, what else? We spoke about the pratincoles this morning, so there are a number of different birds. The kingfishers, woodland kingfisher, and that, they migrate. All the cuckoos migrate. So there are a lot of bird species, John, that do migrate during the winter, or our winter. They'll migrate north for the summer. And then return down here again for our summer. Let's see what else we can find. I've just found a spider web. A lot of little spiders around still. I have not seen that many golden orb web spiders like we usually see, and I find that very interesting. And I wonder if it hasn't got something to do with the drought that we had, perhaps. Maybe, I'm not sure. But it definitely affected, I think, some of the movement. Also, the amount of chameleons and that we see, but perhaps we're just not that good at spotting them. That could be the other reason. Let's see what we can find. I would like to find another scorpion. Haven't seen one of those for a while. And now there are little water holes up ahead, mud wallows. Never know, there could be something that's come down to drink. So always have a look around there. Look very, very carefully, and I'm scanning the bush. See what we can find. Maybe little frogs around here too, although the frogs haven't been very vocal lately. Here we go. There's the little. Let's just listen for a second. Nothing. nothing for the moment. A few crickets calling. It's beautiful. Lovely sounds. So Kiki Beth, a lot of the birds that we see at night now, these nocturnal birds, fly down and sit on the roads because they're looking for insects. The roads hold a lot of heat during the day, and there will be a lot of insects moving around on the road, so it's a bit easier for those birds. For one, they gain a bit of warmth from the road, and also to look for insects that they might potentially feed on. So that is why these nocturnal birds like to sit on the roads. It's a bit warmer and a bit easier to see little insects walking past. You know what I haven't spotted in a tree for quite some time at night is a snake. Now, when I worked with my friend Judas, he was excellent at spotting snakes in trees at night. And he taught me how to do it and what to look for, but it's not that easy. It really isn't that easy. But we'll see. You never know. But yeah, I haven't seen a snake in a tree at night for quite some time. Some wonderful smells in the bush at the moment. There's an impala lying down. I'm not going to shine on him. But there's a real grassy smell, like fresh grass smell. And also because we're dropping lower down at the moment, we're approaching a drainage line. So what happens is in the evenings, the cold air is a lot heavier and it sinks down, so it traps that smell. Any smell that might be in the area, it will trap it lower down, so it becomes a lot stronger. And that's why we can smell it at the moment. If grassy... Yeah, man, that's the best way to describe it. A thick, grassy smell. Fresh grass smell. I just heard something back here. What was that? Thought I heard something move through the bush. That's a thing. While you are driving around, you've got to rely on your hearing, not just your eyesight, but your hearing and your sense of smell, especially when the bush is so thick. Let's see, are there no scorpions around? I really hope you have all enjoyed this afternoon with us. It's been a really, really exciting drive. It's been a lot going on. I think I heard this name correctly. Take care or cake care? Take care. And you wanted to know why is it warm on the road? So the roads are very exposed during the day. So the heat of the sun will warm up the road, and generally what happens is it will maintain or retain that heat for a little bit longer. So it just becomes a bit warmer and stays warmer during the course of the evening, as opposed to these areas that are covered in vegetation. So that is why. Alright, now let's head back to Tristan quickly and see where Mvula is going.
Well, Mvula has now crossed into Wolf's Hook, so he's on his way away. I can't follow him any further than where we are now, but he's definitely on the scent of something. He's following the scent, and he keeps sniffing all the grass. He's actually even been scent marking, which is quite interesting. So he did a scent mark over the top of another leopard. He was Fleming grimacing. So I don't know if he's maybe picked up, like I say, this younger male that Taylor saw. It's possibly what he's picked up and what he's busy smelling. But isn't that a beautiful picture as he just slinks through this grass and into the night and away? Now, I was hoping that we would have spent the whole night with him and gotten a lot more time with him maybe hunting on our side, but it seems like he's heard something to the north because he picked up his head and started moving straight north as soon as he could. So there he goes, off he goes into the distance. And that's going to be it for us in Mvula. But it has been an absolutely amazing evening, and to spend time with this leopard the whole afternoon has been really quite special. Firstly, I do know some of Mvula's offspring, so I know we can still actually get a visual of him. So we have Shivambalan, which I think is from him. It's difficult because it could have been him or Jordan, so we're not 100% sure. He's just slinking off into that gap there, Craig. I don't think you'll get, but there he is. I see a bit of scent marking that he's doing. He's rubbing his face up on the tree there. So Shivambalan could be either Jordan or Mvula. Then there was Wabayiza, which unfortunately got killed by the Styx Pride. Then there was, I'm trying to think, Kuchava is one of Mvula's offspring. Bahuti, which is another one of Tandi's. So there are quite a few. Sindile could also be him. It's debatable if it's Tingano or him as well. So there's quite a number of them. Right, now Byron has got a small little animal that bounces around all over the show. So let's go across to him and see what he's got.
Yes, look everybody, two little bush babies. I've been trying to keep them curious just by making a small little noise, but watch. Watch, there they go. There they go, look at that. Watch, the other one should be coming soon, let's see. Where did the other one go? It's still there, there it is. Just still in the tree. Oh, beautiful. Let's see if we get it jumping. Just shine the light a little bit in front of it. It might encourage it to jump. Follow the other one. I wonder if they don't sleep in this tree somewhere. Look at that. There it is. That looks like a tiny little one. Perhaps a youngster. Watch. Okay, watch. I think we're going to get a leap from it. Let's see. Yeah. There we go. On the ground. Oh, great. Sorry, I've got flies, little insects flying in my face. Wasn't that great? Two little bush babies jumping across the road. Oh. And that was Dave laughing. It wasn't the bush baby calling. They're still around here. They're just at the top of this tree now. Wow, what a wonderful bush baby sighting. I mean, you all know, usually they disappear quite quickly. And there they go. It's amazing jumpers. There they go. What a wonderful view. And they still are. There they are. Gee, this has been a very, very special evening. I hope all of you are enjoying it and watching with us. This needs to go in a highlights package, Rebecca. Watch, this little one might jump. There we go. Oh, amazing jumpers. There they go. Lovely. Hey, wasn't that great? So special. Really special. And I say it's special, but I do mean it. It's because I know that at times you really need to be lucky to see them. Never mind spend time and see them jumping around like that. So that was great. Oh, we see. What Steph says, they remind you of super gliders. You know, the incredibly agile jumpers, but amazing ability to spring from one tree and one branch to another. And as you saw, even on the road. Now, that could be an interesting tracking question, seeing a little bush baby track on the road. That I think that could stump a lot of people, or a lot of guides, that's for sure. Claire, now the bush baby anatomy is designed to jump. So they've got almost like, the best way to describe it was they have like spring-loaded legs that are able to absorb the shock from those long jumps and then obviously shoot off again. So as they land, they absorb that shock of them landing, and then they spring off again and start jumping. So all that movement and that design allows them to jump like that without injuring themselves. And it's just the way that the bush babies have evolved and that they are able to jump like that. Tim, I don't know why they are called bush babies. I really don't know the history behind that name. The other name for a bush baby is a galago. That is the other term for a bush baby, but they are part of the primate family. But I'm not sure why they are called bush babies. They cute, they small, and you see them at night in the bush. Bush baby? I don't know. I'm not sure. I don't know. It's a good question. I'm not sure where the name bush baby actually comes from. Girl of Fire, you want to know if the bush babies are social or solitary. Now, you do see them occasionally in small pairs, or two, three. Small pairs, either a pair or small groups, two or three or four occasionally. I think the most I've seen together has been about four, but so small family groups or a pair, and then they usually move off. What was that? Something flew into me. But they occasionally you might get one alone, but that might be a male perhaps that's looking for females. But from what I've seen, they are usually in small groups, small family groups. And when it's usually a pair, and then if you get more together, then it will usually be the youngsters that are with them. There's something attacking us in the vehicle. It's flying around. I think it's attacking Dave at the moment. You're right there, Dave? Let's see if there aren't some big owls around here, perhaps. Still need to try find a chameleon, chameleon. Let's see if we can find one. But what an exciting day. Lions, well, yeah, we saw lions and jackal and then those honey badger. That was a highlight. That's a highlight for me for a while, is those honey badger. And then a lot of nocturnal birds around, the bush babies. Oh, Sarah, thank you very much. Apparently you draw a picture and you were so excited about the honey badger sighting too, and you don't know if you what made you happier, my excitement or the honey badger. Well, I promise you, I can't tell you how that made my day. Or like I say, that's made a safari dream of mine for a while. I've been trying to find honey badger and I've just struggled. It's so funny how things happen. So thank you, Sarah. I look forward to seeing that picture. I can't seem to find a little chameleon, but those bush babies were great to see. And then, of course, Tayla had the elephant that she viewed on foot, and Tristan had the leopard. So there was a lot going on today. It was a very special day out there. A rewarding day, I would say. Definitely very rewarding. Still no chameleon, Dave. Or a scorpion, interesting. Okay, so I think that's a goodbye from myself and Dave for today. hope you've all enjoyed it. It's been a wonderful, wonderful afternoon, and we will see you all tomorrow morning. Let's head over to Tristan and get an update on where Mvula went, and a goodbye. Bye, everyone.
Well, Byron, it has been an absolutely wonderful day and a wonderful weekend. We had a very quiet week, but our weekend has been spectacular. We've had that crazy jackal interaction with the impala, followed by Taylor's heron catching a catfish. Then she got the caracal. Then there was the puff adder. Then this morning we had lions. It's all been very spectacular. The honey badger, Mvula, so many different sightings this weekend. It's been really, really, really something spectacular. Now, also, we've had little sightings too, so it's been so nice to see things like those spiders. And that's the best part about being out here on Safari Live, is that with guests, sometimes you wouldn't be able to show them those spiders. They wouldn't be able to see that. But with the cameras that we've got and these infrared lights, we're able to show you those small little things that are absolutely fascinating and form a part of this whole ecosystem. So it's been really, really cool to be a part of that, and to be able to showcase those things and share it with all of you is a very special thing. Now, in terms of where Mvula went straight north. Pretty much from where I was, he just cut straight north and I lost visual of him. And he, like I say, it's interesting because he was scenting the whole time. So his nose was down on the ground, walking as he was going and sniffing, phlegm and grimace, scent marking, rubbing his face on trees, which is something a territorial male would do. So I'm quite surprised that he was doing that. The last two times I've seen him, which one was fairly recently and the other one was quite a while ago, both of those times there was no scent marking whatsoever. So I wonder, with this bit of rain, if Tingana hasn't been a bit naughty and hasn't come and checked his boundaries and reaffirmed his territory and scent marked this area, and now there's no scent. So Mvula is just taking it and utilizing it for himself at the moment. It'll be really cool if we see him and Tingana on a regular basis around the Djuma area. Now I'm just checking carefully, just in case that young male leopard is somewhere here. You never know, maybe that would just be the cherry on the top for the weekend if little Sindile popped out and we could all see how he's doing. Right, so some of you may have noticed that in the mornings we get going and it's very, very dark and it's not easy to see what's going on, and even in the evenings we're battling a little bit with nighttime. So we are going to be changing the times on the 1st of April, so we're going to just be adjusting slightly just to coincide with the sunrises and sunsets. We will let all of you know the exact times closer to the 1st of April, but just so that you know that that is going to be taking place. I'm sure it will be about a half an hour shift later in the morning and earlier in the afternoons. It's normally about that. That's normally how we do things, in little half an hour increments, and that helps us to be able to just be in time with the sunrise and sunset and spend the maximum amount of time out at the right time. So during the times when animals are going to be active, and that we can showcase what's going on the best way possible. Just checking, no more signs of bush babies. I'm very jealous. Taylor and Byron have both had amazing bush baby sightings, and they get their name from the way that they call. So they cry like a baby, and because they're often associated with a tree or a bush, that's where the bush comes from, and the sound is from a baby, and that's why they're called a bush baby. Right, it's that time of the evening for us to start saying our goodbyes. It's been a really wonderful weekend that we've had. So from myself and Craig, and then Byron, Dave, Viam, the proud new uncle, and Taylor, say a very, very big goodbye, and we'll see you all tomorrow morning on our sunrise safari.